we're going to call the order of the work session for the Cole County Board of Education for April 22nd, 2021. I'll ask Dr. Banks if we'll get an indication.
Let us pray. Dear Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come before you at this appointed time, asking you, Father God, to instill in us great values that we will lead our community in a pathway that is accredited because we are living the Word of God. I ask, Father God, this afternoon that you will deposit love in our hearts. Father God, deposit mutual understanding. Deposit the tenacity to love our neighbor as thyself. When we do these things, Father God, we'll be able to make a withdrawal in times of need. We'll be able to make a withdrawal of love to help that child who may be contemplating suicide. Help the child who has been threatened. And we ask, Father God, that you give us the ability to have forgiveness in our hearts, knowing that in this life, we all have imperfections. Imperfections will lead to sin, and sin will lead to imperfections. I ask in the name of Jesus, let us embody the character of love in our hearts tonight. Bless our leaders. Bless our superintendent and our board members. All of the staff affiliated with Coffee County School System, certified and classified. Let us work together and strive to be on one accord tonight. And from this day forward, we continue to acknowledge you in all our ways so that you will direct our path. This prayer we ask in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, in Jesus Christ's most holy and righteous name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Everybody's got a copy of the agenda for the motion to adopt.
I move we adopt the agenda as presented.
Preston.
I'm sure.
Mr. Wade. All in favor?
Aye.
John Lewis.
Yes, sir. I'd like to welcome everybody here tonight. I'm going to take my mask off, if that's okay. I have been vaccinated. I've had both shots, and so I'm going to take my mask off for a few minutes while we do this meeting. So, anyways, welcome to all of our visitors. We've got visitors here tonight, and good to see all of you here, and we're going to begin the business of the Coffee County Board of Education. The first item on the agenda is the FY22 budget hearing, number one, and we will move forward with the budget hearing. So this part of the meeting will begin our budget hearing, and I've got Ms. Tracy Yawn here, board members, our finance director, who will present the information to the board for the budget hearing. So, Ms. Yawn?
Yes, sir. The document that we see here is our budget process and timeline to prepare the FY22 budget. Beginning in February, we met with principals and directors of departments and analyzed enrollment, and we went through the staffing of each school to determine the staffing levels. And we also met with directors to analyze their budgets and their needs for the upcoming fiscal year. Also in February, at the end of February, we had our board retreat, and during that time we presented the results of those meetings to the board so that we could begin preparing for the FY22 budget. During March, we began formulating the budget, the revenue and expenditures, plugging them into our financial system and generating those numbers so we can begin making spreadsheets so we know kind of where we are. During this meeting, this will be our first public hearing that we're required to have, and we will be presenting the projected revenues at this meeting. During the March 6th meeting, which would also be a public hearing, the second public hearing, we will go through the expenditures and present the tentative budget overall. Then we would like to, after that meeting, advertise the tentative budget for 2 weeks, and at the end of May, have a call board meeting where we approve the budget. And then in June, we would begin uploading and inputting the information into our financial system for, to be prepared for July 1. And then in the month of July, we'll be getting meeting with our tax commissioner office and working on the tax digest. And we'd present that to the board in July or August, depending on the tax commissioner's office, and then get approval at the end of August for that meeting. So is there any questions on the kind of the timeline?
If we look at the timeline, board members, we'll have the May meeting on May 6th, and we'll advertise the tentative budget on the 7th. We'll get it to them.
Yep.
We'll run it. They'll run it on the 11th. Is that correct?
Let's see.
We'll advertise the tentative budget for 2 weeks.
It would need to be in the paper for the 13th, May 13th and May 20th.
Right.
So we can meet any time. You know, it would have to go for 2 weeks. So some, the week of the 24th.
All right.
You know.
So could we look at either doing, I've got an 8:30 to 12 on the 24th, do a call meeting on the 24th at any time from noon forward that day. It'll be a quick meeting. That's a Monday the 24th. Or we could do Tuesday the 25th. I could do any time that day up until about 3 o'clock on the 25th.
So how long do you say a meeting?
It would be less than an hour. It's usually a very short meeting just to approve the final budget. So either the 24th or 25th. If y'all want to just look at those dates and then we can get back together on it. And all we'd have to have the quorum to approve the final budget then. So we get it approved on those dates, then that would work with our schedule to
yes.
get everything
done.
Yes,
we just need to advertise for those 2 weeks, 4 weeks.
All right. Great.
Okay.
Yeah, that's right. We can get back together. We've got a meeting coming up on the 6th. I'll get with y'all individually between now and the next meeting to finalize which one of those days we're doing. All right, Ms. Young.
Okay, the document here is the Coffee County salary schedule for our certified employees. This will be the salary schedule used for FY22, where we'll use this to calculate the salaries. This is our current salary schedule as well. We also used it in FY20. This is the Coffee County salary schedule due to the additional step, L7, for the employees that have 23 plus years on the schedule. So just, this is the one that we will be using for their calculation of their salaries.
And as she mentioned, Mr. Wade, I know you're new to the board, and we discussed this in the finance training, but just to review, we have the Coffee County salary schedule, and we have our state representative here with us this evening. We sure appreciate you being here, Mr. Larickia. Thank you for being here tonight, and I want to thank y'all for your funding over the years that's allowed us to do this and support the charter system, which gives us flexibility so that we can create our own salary schedule, and that's what we've done in Coffee County. So if you looked at the state salary schedule, you would not see that last step. That step 23 is right here. This up would be the state salary schedule, but our Coffee County Board of Education has created a step 23 that goes beyond the normal state salary schedules that all other systems would use. Our board chose to add a step 23 for those employees who get the year beyond year 21 or 22, where typically people on the state salary schedule, they stop moving. But in Coffee County, we have a step 23, where they'll get one additional step that in other counties, they wouldn't necessarily get, all right? So I want to thank our board for allowing us to use our own salary schedule that goes a little beyond what other counties in the state do. So we like to think that's a recruitment tool also. So if anybody has teachers out there in other counties that might consider coming to Coffee County, they could have an opportunity to have a step beyond what they would find in their county. So anyways, we'll make sure everybody understood. That's one of the reasons we want to share the salary schedule with everybody, because it is different than just the regular state salary schedule.
Okay, the document here, this is our proposed FY22 revenue budget. The top portion is our local revenue, consists of our property tax and motor vehicle, mobile home, and TABT. The first column is the FY21 budget. This is what we budgeted last year when we started this fiscal year. The second column is where we are projecting we'll be at, okay? And the third column is the 22 budget that we are proposing. So for fiscal year 22, for the local revenue, we're proposing the $15,149,000 for that portion. The next portion of the spreadsheet is the other local revenue, which consists of textbooks that are returned, smaller items. So we'll budget that as kind of close as we did last year. There's not much change in other local revenue. Okay. The next portion is the state QBE. This is the allotment that we receive from the state. So the first column is the 21 budget. And you can see in that column that we received an austerity reduction of approximately $4.5 million for fiscal year 21.
And that was a result of COVID. When COVID hit last March, everybody was real concerned about what the effect would be on the economy. So our state legislators and governor took a very conservative approach, which wound up being a very good approach to take, because they were very worried about revenue. And of course, we saw the effects of that. And so they put in place this austerity of $4.5 million basically, and we budgeted for $4.5 million in austerity. So we budgeted to be able to, remember, there were some positions we were going to add last year, those dean positions, and there were several other positions we were finally going to come around and be able to do that we've been talking about for years. And there were several different things that we were going to do last year that when the austerity hit, we had to put those things on hold and wait and see how the revenue turned out. All right, so we budgeted for $4.5 million in austerity. I think it's important for everybody to understand that for where we're at right now, okay? And because it is very relevant to this year's budget and some things we may want to do moving over through the next few months. So we were budgeting for $4.5 million in austerity. And then last month,
The next column is the FY21 projected. So last month we received our midterm adjustment from the Department of Education, and on that they restored, or the legislators restored, some of the austerity. So now the reduction is $1.8 million. So that is, they restored approximately $2.6 million to our funding for fiscal year 21 that we'll receive through June 30, we'll receive those funds that were not budgeted. That's additional funding.
So, board member, I just want to make sure everybody's real clear on, we were budgeting for this much austerity we thought was going to be withheld. So we withheld on doing some things, backed off on filling some positions, and our people did a great job of just tightening their belt. right? But then we found out about a month ago, and it's good news, that it's only going to be this much. So that means we're bringing in more state revenue at this point than we budgeted for, which is a good thing. It puts us in a good place, all right?
The next column is our proposed 22 budget. And you can also see, we will still have an austerity for fiscal year 22 of approximately 1.8 million. Now, what we're planning to do is, with the funding through CARES, CARES 2, we're going to use the funding that we receive to offset that reduction. And we're going to budget salaries and benefits and fuel costs and utilities in the general fund budget that we normally would put in the general fund budget. We're going to put those into CARES, we'll shift it to the CARES to offset that austerity reduction, okay? And we plan to do that for this fiscal year and the next fiscal year, depending on, you know, what happens next year. The remaining portion of CARES 2, we have budgeted for after-school programs, summer school, an additional 3,000 Chromebooks, and we've also budgeted for flooring improvements and replacement of doors and windows. That is in that budget. At this time, we have submitted CARES 2 and CARES 3 to the Department of Ed. We have got response back from CARES 2 where they needed further information. We have sent that information and again signed off. So we're hoping to have that budget, CARES 2, signed off by next week. So that we come back on May 6th, we can go through the expenditures and we can be sure what we've done with the salaries and benefits, so we can show you that.
And just to be clear, and you correct me if I state something that's not correct here, Michelle, but we're going to use the CARES 2 to cover that, and to cover that, and then to do some of the work that you just described.
It'll be the 1.8
right.
million.
All right.
Yes.
All right.
That we're, yes.
Great. And then CARES 3, we have submitted budget
to
the state.
And we haven't heard back from CARES 3 yet.
Yeah.
So I'm assuming once we get CARES 2 approved, then they will look at CARES 3. Now, CARES 3 is more of capital projects, you know, that we discussed, the HVAC upgrades and things of that nature. But CARES 2 will help us with the austerity reduction.
And hopefully by our May 6th meeting, we'll know where we're at with CARES 2 and CARES 3 as far as approval for the budget we submitted to it. All right.
Okay. Moving on through the spreadsheet. The next portion is other state revenue, and you can see equalization there. For 21, it remains the same, but for 22, we had an increase in equalization. And then the next line item is our charter system funding, and it remained the same for 21, but in 22, we had a slight reduction in our charter funding. And the rest of those programs are our CTAE grants, mainly in our preschool, and we'll kind of budget those like we, you know, did for 21. Those will remain the same. Then the next portion is our federal grants, our Medicaid, and we're going to budget that at the same amount too as we did the previous year. So when you come on down to the final line item, you can see that our revenue that we're budgeting there, we proposing for 22, is the $69,877,345. Any questions on that?
If there's no questions about the budget information thus far, our plan is to come back, as we outlined on the calendar, at the May 6th meeting and present the expenditure that will give the final presented budget, including expenditures. So there's no questions, that we'll resume we will finish our budget hearing number one and move on to school update. We have Ms. Sherry Berry here from Coffee Middle School. Welcome, Ms. Berry. And Ms. Berry's going to give us an update of activities and things going on at Coffee Middle School.
Thank you for the opportunity, Dr. Lees and board members, for me to be able to come and share with you tonight some of the things going on at Coffee Middle School. As part of the strategic plan, and I'm sure Dr. Lees has shared that with you many times, as part of our strategic plan in focus area one, which is teaching and learning, it directs all the schools under strategy one to define and develop a framework for project-based learning at each grade level or grade band. And as the middle school, we are the stepping stone to Coffee High, where they have the academies model that is full in place. And we, project-based learning is a very vital part to that because they have a capstone project as a senior that they are to complete. And that's all tied into project-based learning. So part of our video, I want to make sure I explain that, because part of the video that you're going to see is directly tied to project-based learning. But the screen that you see before you just gives some demographic information. Our enrollment is 1,777 students. Currently we have 1,389 in person. I think today we got three more students, two from Florida and one from somewhere else, a little bit more than that. But and then 388 who are either virtual or at-home learners. And then you can see the breakdown based on ethnicity. And then over to the right, it's kind of faded out, but you see we have 904 males and 873 females, so almost a dead even. In the past, we've had more females. Fortunately, we got more boys now. And then in the very bottom of the green, you see our numbers of faculty and staff. We have 171 employees, 130 of those are certified staff, and then 41 are classified. This video kind of depicts how the school year started and then where we are now.
I have today declared that the coronavirus presents a public health emergency in the United States.
Public health emergency.
A declaration of emergency.
State of emergency.
Stay at home.
Stay home, stay safe.
Quite simply, stay at home.
COVID-19 can be characterized as a pandemic.
started off cleaning, and we had an empty school. We were so glad to start back.
Thank you, Mr. Perry.
Perry, real quick, how many, roughly, how many bursaries did you have when it started compared to?
Around 403. And then we, about 171, 73 of those were coming back after Christmas, and then, you know, we had that other little break, and after that with the at-home, where I think we're like 388 on that slide, but I think now it's more like at 372 or something.
Yeah, I'll just give you, thanks.
Everyone had a chance to look at the minutes. Okay, we just put a little concern in there. That good? Financial report?
We've got our financial report, and you will see that we had a month-ending fund equity of $24,215,662.41. So it's fund balance has remained healthy over the past 12 months, and we're looking forward to closing out the books on June 30th. So. Ms. Young, you got anything to add to that document?
Budget remains strong.
And our earlier during the budget hearing, that was why I wanted to explicitly point out that austerity that originally we budgeted for experiencing, that we're now receiving that money. So that's why our fund balances remain healthy right now, where typically it would have dropped a little bit. All right. And this is the comparison report, in which we compare previous years at this point in time. Any questions about those numbers? Document. Ms. Young, you want to walk us through this detail?
Sir, this is our detailed report as of March 31st, 2021. It begins with our revenues. And as of March, we have received $46,703,034.23. And the next portion is the expenditures by function of the school system. And as of March 31, the expenses amount to $41,837,089.92. So that leaves us with our fund equity of the $24,215,662.41.
The next document is our East Bloss summary. Our East Bloss was down a little this past month.
Well, actually, that's February.
Yeah.
Trails month.
That's right.
Probably looking at the last Bloss, like that month's typically in that ballpark anyway. It's not, it's not one of our
after Christmas things.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Any questions about the East Bloss report? Local economy's looking strong. I don't know if y'all noticed when you came up, the Hobby Lobby wall's going up.
So, and the Starbucks is coming to fruition down there. So, not long we'll have the coffee smells and the chicken smells, and I'll be lucky to go to shopping and stuff.
We've got to lock the doors from the inside.
Yeah.
Here.
All right.
Are these things installed, what's the bad system called?
Syntegic.
Syntegic, we'll have to install those.
That's right.
At the stores for y'all.
And the next item on the agenda is the Satilla Regional Library Board of Trustees. It's time to appoint, and we're asking the board to reappoint. And it's Karen Madden agrees to serve a second three-year term. Director of the library is very pleased, and Ms. Batten agrees, and so we are asking that Ms. Batten be approved to serve. And that'll be placed on the consent agenda at the regular monthly meeting. All right. Bids. We've got a number of bids that we're going to ask the board to approve. We have been planning for several years to do improvements at the George Washington Carver campus. We put an RFP out for renovations at George Washington Carver, and those renovations will include improvements to the bathrooms, restrooms in the school on the campus. We're going to put new fixtures in those restrooms, partitions, we're going to paint new ceiling, epoxy floor. We're going to put in the nice epoxy floor that we see in at the high school where we did renovations, and in our newer projects we've done the epoxy floors. And so that'll cut down on the grime and the germs and things that you find in restrooms. And given the importance of COVID and what we've experienced over the last 12 months, we're going to put new HVAC in the bathrooms and the new flooring, so it'll make a much more sterile and more of a safe environment, healthy environment for our students on that campus. So the epoxy floor, vapor detectors, we all know the dangers of vaping, and I think there was legislation that was passed in this session to add vaping to the list of things that can be harmful to young people. And so we're putting a vaping detectors to protect our young people from the dangers of that. And so we're going to put those in the restrooms, new HVAC to improve the air quality in the restrooms, and then new exhaust system in the restrooms. So the restrooms will all be like brand new. Lunchroom, we're going to put new serving lines, new ceiling tile, new light fixtures, and new flooring. So the lunchroom area will look brand new in the ninth grade George Washington Carver campus. And then in the kitchen, this is where the bulk of the real heavy work will go on. We're going to remove all the quarry tile floor in the base and install epoxy floor and base, painting, replace walk-in cooler and freezer, new exhaust for the kitchen hood, new air conditioning, replace all electrical wiring and panels, new light fixtures, replace all plumbing lines, new ceiling grids and tiles, and new grease trap. So, and then finally remove the dishwasher, convert space to storage. So this is going to bring the kitchen area, the cafeteria area, and all the restrooms on George Washington Carver campus up to modern specs. So we're real excited about this. The bids were put out, the RFP was put out, and we received the bid packages from three contractors. Two of our local contractors submitted bids, and we are asking the board to approve tonight the low base bid from Charles E. Lewis Construction of $1,406,111. There was a add option alternate of the Halo smart sensor, which is the vape detector. It also will detect noise, extreme noise like fighting or anything like that in a restroom, or what else does it do? It's
aerosol.
aerosols, if somebody has some kind of THC, so if somebody is smoking marijuana or anything like that in the restrooms, it would pick that up. So it's a real slick device that will help increase the safety on our ninth grade campus. So that the extra for that was $14,784. So we're asking the board to accept the bid from Charles E. Lewis. Is there any questions?
When is this going to get started?
They're going to start in the next couple of weeks. Okay. Michael, do you have an estimate on start date?
Not yet. But I mean, it's supposed to be sometime in May, is what I understood.
Yeah, they want to get in there as soon as, even before the kids get out in some of the areas. And, Dawn has been working to be ready for food prep on other campuses and such. So as soon as we approve this, they're going to mobilize, start. All right. If there's no questions, we've got that as a separate item on the regular meeting agenda. So we'll vote that separate. It won't be on the consent agenda, I thought. Item that big, we'll vote separate. All right. Technology. We have several technology bids. Dr. Newell is presenting these bids, and we've discussed these in our work session and in our retreat that we had back in February. Whiteboards. We have whiteboards, which are what we project in the classrooms, just like that. Many of our whiteboards are approaching 20 years old, aren't they? Is that 15 years at least?
We'll be replacing the active boards. Some of those are 18 years old.
18 years old. So that equipment is time to be replaced. So that's what these whiteboards will be replacing. And you'll see that the Kurtz Brothers had the low price, and the total for that is $43,279. And we're asking for that to go ahead and be approved because it's time sensitive. There's going to be a
6 to 8 week
lead time so that the contractor can get those ordered and get them installed before the students come back in the fall. So we're asking for you to go ahead and approve that purchase tonight. All right. The next item is the technology updates, projectors. So we'll have the new whiteboards, and we'll also have new projectors to go up. And
east side and west side.
East side and west side. So we have the projectors. They were advertised, and the bids were due April 13th. 11 bids were received. We're asking the board to approve the low bid, which was ABI SPL. The total price of $155,302 for these new projectors.
Where are these people out of?
South Florida.
South Florida.
We bought them twice. Yes. This will be on next maybe.
Yeah, this one's not time sensitive, so we'll just approve it at the next month's meeting.
Along with the installation.
All right. The installation of projectors and whiteboards with Southern Technology Partners at $390 per room, and that's $39,000.
They are out of Hazelhurst.
Great. So they're a local vendor out of Hazelhurst.
On
May 6th meeting. All right. And then the security camera upgrade. This will finish out the new security cameras on all of our campuses. The request for proposals were posted March 12th. Proposals were due April 13th. 21 proposals were received. This is for 10 schools. We'll put in a modern security camera system for security purposes on those campuses. And the low proposal was from, how do you say that?
Acelutech.
$485,749.
Use them before?
Yes, sir. Use them. That will, this will get all 12 schools on the same level.
And I know the high schools, this is the same system we have at the high school that we just fired up this year. And they've been very pleased. I thought Van Allen out there, he did a lot of those security and physical cases, and cameras have been great. So. All right. And we are asking the board to approve those at the May meeting? The cameras tonight. All right. Because it, once again, that's time sensitive.
They're prepared to start the game like next week.
Yes, sir. All right, if it pleases the board, we'll place some of those items on the consent agenda for tonight's meeting, and then we'll have others on the May meeting, as discussed a few minutes ago. Now, maintenance. We have a maintenance request from the maintenance department for a scissor lift, and we've been talking about a scissor lift for quite some time, a couple of years, and we've been renting a scissor lift, and we're asking the board to allow us to go ahead and purchase a scissor lift. That way we don't have to schedule with the vendor and try to go pick it up or have it delivered or whatnot. So the price is $29,942.10. And I've got Mr. Spikes here to answer any questions about it if needed. Any questions about scissor lift? All right, the next item is the new policy descriptor code, GBIA. Teacher evaluation appeal. This is a policy that's going to be required as a result of a change in the law and State Board of Education rules. And Ms. Spade is here to describe this policy change for us. Ms. Spade, you want to explain to the board what this is?
Yes, sir. Good evening. As Dr. Lee stated, due to a state law revision, local school boards are required to adopt a new policy for teacher evaluation appeals. The detailed appeals policy is based on a change in code section 20-2-989.7, which identified matters not subject to complaint, including performance ratings contained in personnel evaluations, professional development plans, and job performance. So the 2020 changes to this code provide that for teachers who have accepted their local Board of Education school year contract for the fourth year or subsequent consecutive school years, excluding transfer eligibility, the following issues are subject to appeal. Summative performance ratings of unsatisfactory or ineffective contained in personnel evaluations conducted pursuant to code 20-2-10. Procedural deficiencies on the part of the local school system or charter school in conducting an evaluation, and job performance. A sample appeals process document was provided for guidance, and was revised for Coffee County Schools. The proposed version has been provided for you and outlines the appeals process. The policy will sit for 30 days before approval, and it must be submitted to the State Board of Education no later than July the 1st, 2021. And then at that time, it will be coming into effect.
All right. Any questions of Ms. Faye?
In layman's terms, what's the difference in this and what we had?
Before, they did not have the opportunity to appeal about their ratings, the job performance, different things, professional learning, and now this just gives them the opportunity to do so.
Appeal
I'm sorry.
Gives them ability to appeal that.
Yes, those areas. They were not able to appeal them before.
Thank you, Ms. Faye.
Yes, sir.
The next item on the agenda is the 2021-22 student handbook. And we have Dr. Banks here with us tonight to describe the changes to the handbook.
Good afternoon to everyone. And I'm here to talk about our handbook, which is how basically our guidelines for how we operate within our system, day-to-day operations of our school. And here with me, I would say that probably about a month and a half ago, we had an opportunity to visit RESA in Waycross. We had a handbook session of things that we might want to put in the handbook for the 2021-2022 school year. And they talked about promotion and retention, talked about attendance, talked about virtual opportunities, and just in general code of conduct information. You know, with a lot of things that we have in our system, we have a lot of things in place, but we didn't have a need for any promotion retention updates or any attendance updates because a lot of times our kids are out during the pandemic, it was labeled COVID exempt. So we didn't have any problems in those areas. But one of the main things you look at when you want to look at implement the handbook for the following year, you want to get stronger and you want to get better. You want to look at things that we're doing now that we need to continue doing into the next school season. And you also want to look at things that we're doing now that you might want to stop doing going into the next school season. And there are some things that we may not be doing at all that we need to start doing in the upcoming season. And all those things are designed to make us a stronger and more efficient school district. So, Shannon, you will scan that up to, I think, page 2. We have some changes that we want to make, and what we've done with the policies that we have, those things that you see in green is what we want to implement for the upcoming school year. And you see there, right off the bat, we always talk about the dress code every year. There's something new within the dress code or pertaining to the dress code because things change. The latest fads are in place, so kids want to be updated to how society is dressing in our culture. But one thing from Coffey Middle School and also Coffey High School, they actually sent a referral to me or a proposal to me and said that they don't want to have students wear clothing that had holes above the knee. So that's one of the recommendations from Coffey High School and the middle school. Any item or any clothing item that students wear, they're not supposed to wear it with holes above the knee. And that's highlighted there for unacceptable for all students in green. Also, if you go back to number 7 there, you see they want to modify that statement as well to go with pants, jeans, shorts, skirts, shirts, tights, etc. Must be free from holes above the knees. So that's a recommendation coming from grades 6 through 8 and 9 through 12 at Coffey High School. Coffey High School is 10 through 12. Any questions on that?
What is it now?
What is it now? Actually, it's supposed to be no holes at all within the school system.
Me, that would be easier to do than trying to figure out where the holes at. You know, no holes is no holes. Period.
That was a recommendation coming from them. I just try to challenge that. I wanted to present it to you guys to see what your opinions are as to how we might want to operate our next school season. Any comments, suggestions, we can table it and come back again on May 6th and see what the vote may be or just talk about it now in general. But that was a recommendation coming from Coffey Middle School and Coffey High School.
It seems like it caused more problem trying to decipher. I mean, if you don't have holes, you don't have to worry about what they have.
But I guess sometimes when they look at
the tear.
Say again.
Sometimes you have a little tear yourself, a load or whatever. that's not, you know, just so provocative or whatever. I'm still on top of this whole floor, you know, but I'm one vote.
I agree with the hours.
You think I'm gonna say no holes, period?
I do. We don't need children distracted looking at people's legs and stuff like that, Rose. They need to be learning.
I don't think that's a distraction, just watching legs, because you'll see them all going to ball games, and if you're that hard up to watch somebody's legs during class time, then you just a pervert in the beginning. You know, legs gonna be seen, whether they old or young.
How about if we, I'd like to hear more from our middle school and high school administration to see what their rationale is on this.
Well, part of it, you give the kids more options when they go shopping, the parents go shopping to buy certain items, because with the fashions that are out there, a lot of things that the kids are wearing, they have holes in it. So you give the parents more options to wear certain items. If you shut down and say no holes, period, then they might be kind of limited on what they can purchase or afford for their child coming to school.
Did we have this policy in place last year, no holes, period?
Yes.
For all of last year, and it worked?
No.
I would say, it did not work to be.
Because they went on
the way we wanted it to work. Yeah. That's why they're coming with us now for asking for recommendations to change it, because they feel they'll have more, a better operation of their school system.
Well, that was going to be my question, is if they had it with no holes, period, last year, and now they come back saying, well, allow below the knee, or now say that. And obviously there were some issues that I agree with them. We don't need to be distracted by people with holes all their britches and their pockets sticking out. But once you get below the knee, I don't particularly care if they, you know, I don't see a problem. If that's what they're saying, that, you know, I mean, obviously there's a reason why they've come back and said that now.
I guess it became complicated.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
To keep them without no holes at all.
So as long as they are saying that, look, we're not going to have anything that's distracting when you got holes all up here around you, you know.
They're saying you come to your knee and below, for them it's acceptable. And I guess that will minimize having to get with a child, discipline a child, then they become disrespectful to you because they feel that they're borderline or what have you. And anytime you get in a borderline case, it becomes more subjective. So they're trying to say to the population that we have here, we're going to give you an option to wear pants with holes in them, but just don't wear it above the knee.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't think they need to be wearing holes on there where it's distracting all, but at the same time, I don't want to hamstring them in what they're trying to do.
Right.
So if they're coming back saying we're fine with them below the knee, we just don't want them above the knee, I don't, you know, that's, they deal with it every day, I know. Right. You know.
I'll check on it. We got some time. Decided tonight.
I mean, I'll catch Bob wear on my blue jeans from time to time. Well, if I get a rib up here, I know I can't go to town and go somewhere with them. But if I catch them down there around my boot somewhere, I don't think nothing about it. So technically, I guess you could say, well, you can't come here with us. When I don't know. I mean, I'm just saying, I feel like they had a reason why they said that.
Because
there
was a lot of things going on that they really tolerated, you know, from what I heard in the schools as far as dress code, because you still had the teachers coming in with their thighs out with low cut tops showing their cleavage, you know. So how you gonna expect these children to do things when the teachers coming in with their tails out?
Well, they don't need to be doing that, but
that's what's been done. You know, so you want to talk about the kids with holes around their knees or whatever, and then you can, and you're talking about legs, showing legs, you go out there and look at the teachers and you can see some size. Now that's where they at.
Well, we'll come back to the board with more information on this.
Okay. Go to page 3, I'll change. Okay, here's where we're at next year with virtual learning. We asked
actually not offering virtual learning through our school system, but if you look there, grades 3 through 8, the virtual learning options, there's a website that they're going to have to go to apply for virtual learning. That was a statement that was submitted to me by Ms. Miller. We looked at some virtual things that we did all this past school year, and I will say during this pandemic, it has been a very, very different operation in trying to get students to learn. So we felt that certain things pertaining to virtual learning will have to go through the Department of Education for next year. So that will be the statement that we want to put upon your approval into our handbook for next year.
Yes, we received the guidance from ARESA, Okefenokee RESA, and they received the guidance from Harbin and Hartley, law firm that deals with school law in the state, and this statement comes from that collaboration, and this will meet the level of what we have to offer, and we will refer people who want to pursue virtual to the State Department of Education Clearinghouse that's noted there, grades 3 through 8. Virtual learning options can be found through the Georgia Virtual, through the Georgia Department of Education. And so families that want to pursue virtual, they can pursue that in grades 3 through 12 or 3 through 8. And then other families, if they want to pursue virtual through the Georgia Virtual School, they can go to the Georgia Department of Education Clearinghouse at the Georgia Virtual School and enroll in virtual school there. And then also in grades 9 through 12 in Coffee County, we do have virtual learning offered through the Career Academy, so students could enroll through virtual learning in the Career Academy. So there'll be three options for our students in Coffee County, or a parent could unenroll their child and homeschool. So that would actually be a fourth option if somebody wanted to homeschool their child, and they could go through one of these commercial virtual learning sites like Georgia K-12 or one of those sites and do virtual learning. So this simply guides families towards ways in which they can do virtual learning if they want to do virtual learning. And but we're going to encourage our students to come back to school and get back into the classroom where they can be with a teacher and learning. So we want students in school with teachers learning face to face. And if somebody wants to pursue virtual, they're free to pursue virtual in one of these ways. So we want to make that very public.
You're saying kindergarten through 7th, no virtual. Is that what you're saying?
That's right. We don't have to offer virtual in kindergarten through 2nd, and there's no requirement for that, and there's not a way offered through Georgia Virtual. Is that correct, Ms. Miller?
That's correct.
And for learning to read, students learning those foundational skills, they need to be with a teacher. And that kindergarten, 1st, 2nd grade, those phonetic skills that they develop and the early math skills, those need to be in a classroom with a teacher. So, and if somebody really wants to do something different with their child in kindergarten, 1st or 2nd grade, they can homeschool. They could sign up for homeschool and stay home and school their children through that way. Or they could find some commercial way. Or they could go to another private school or system or whatever if they chose to do that. So, okay.
Change, scroll up, page 17. Okay, we made some changes at the levels. In our handbook, we have levels 1 through 4. These are some recommendations from the high school and the middle school as well. We wanted to put some things pertaining to horse playing and other student instability. 1, which is failure to follow instructions. You see there with the consequences, also it's not highlighted, but tobacco possession use includes vaping devices. Vaping devices and tobacco uses was a level 3 infraction this past school year. Next year we want to put that at level 2 and add the consequences on the level 2 as an educational module. Parent conference, number 2 would be ISSP, 1 to 3 days. on suspension 1 to 5 days per offense. And with that educational module, that will be through like an aid module where they will get to do a module on a particular, learning that they will learn more about the ins and out of not using vaping devices at school. So this year's policy calls for basically on the first offense of vaping was a 3 days home suspension. Kids cannot learn when they're away from school. So the middle school basically wanted to modify that a little differently going into next school season at a level 2 infraction instead of the level 3 that we had this past year. If you look at level 3, that strike through on the yellow for disrespect, normally when you go on the Infinite Campus, which is one of our softwares here we have in Coffee County School System, if you have an infraction, if it's uppercase, you have to have a resolution that's uppercase as well. And sometimes what was happening with the disrespect code is that you might have a lowercase infraction, but you couldn't match what you were trying to give that kid as far as a consequence with a lowercase consequence. So we wanted to modify that going next year and call it other student incivility 2 or 3. And that means that kid is failure, blatant insubordination, they're not following directions at all. So those are some of the things that we're going to change going into next year. Another clarification that I got from Coffin Middle School, it pertains to fights. All right, the middle school level, once that child gets a third fight, they are put in a level 4 offense, which is 10 days pending tribunal, okay? Which is different from fighting at the high school level. Your first offense at the high school level calls for 3 to 5 days home suspension. And Chance, scroll a little bit to a level 4, please.
And Dr. Banks, can I stop you right there just to be clear? When we say 10 days pending a tribunal hearing, that means that the student is suspended. They are suspended, which means they cannot be on the campus until they have that hearing. And let me explain a tribunal hearing. A tribunal hearing is where we will have a closed hearing in here. It's closed to the public, and the public cannot attend this meeting because school discipline is confidential. We cannot go out and disclose publicly what we do to a child for XYZ offense. So if a child on this scale is home suspended pending a tribunal, that means they are removed from the campus. They cannot come on the campus unless they have permission from the school administration for some reason. And there could be a legitimate reason. I could give you an example. Let's say that a student had some kind of meeting educationally related that they had to have with the school to come back on that campus with that parent and meet with the school officials while they were under that suspension. So the administrator, the principal, might have a reason that they had to schedule a meeting with a parent and the student. And if it was something where they were concerned about safety or something, the principal could even have law enforcement there to make sure everything went smooth. But otherwise, the student, when they're suspended for a pending a tribunal hearing, that means they do not come on that campus for that 10-day period until we have that tribunal hearing up here at the board offices. And tribunal hearings are held at the Board of Education office. Dr. Banks presides over the tribunal hearings to make sure they're done correctly. We keep a record of them. It's much like this meeting tonight. It's very formal. Dr. Newell is involved with making sure that we keep a record. We're required to keep a record of the hearing in case there's an appeal to the State Department of Education. And so it's a very, very formal hearing in a very controlled environment, but it is a confidential meeting between that student and that parent and school officials, and it's all done very legal in a way that meets the law because we're required to give students due process. All right? Now, once they come to a hearing like that, the student can be expelled permanently. Students could be put out of school forever, all right? Or they can be expelled for a period of time. They might be expelled for the rest of a semester. They might be expelled for
one calendar year, or the panel, and the panel is made up, there's three members that sit on the panel. They're all school officials who don't know anything about the case. These are school officials who come into the hearing and they hear the case that's presented, the school presents their side of the case, and the parents have a chance to present their case. And everybody has a say into what happened. And then those three school officials will sit like a jury, and then they will decide what penalty the child receives. Sometimes the tribunal may say, hey, after hearing the evidence, we're going to do something less than what the school recommended, because the school will come up with a recommendation. Or sometimes the tribunal panel could say, hey, after we've heard the evidence, we're going to do more than what the school recommended. All right? So the tribunal panel has a lot of authority to be able to make a decision based on the evidence. Yes, ma'am.
How is the panel selected? How is that selected?
All right.
We select the panel based upon that kid not being involved with that school administrator at all during the history of their school. Like if I worked at the freshman campus, mm-hmm. and a kid goes to 10th grade and he gets in violation of something, then I can't be on that tribunal because I've had an affiliation with that child before. So if it's at elementary level.
The panel changes.
Yes, the panel changes. They're not the same people mm-hmm. on every panel. Yeah. We modify that and change that based upon where that child has come from mm-hmm. during his or her schooling career. From elementary on up, yeah. if I had Ms. Christina Tucker at Eastside, mm-hmm. and she had a student in third, fourth, or fifth grade when they were at Eastside, and they got into some type of trouble when they got into middle school. Well, I'm not going to call her on that panel because she's already had prior exposure to that particular kid. Mm-hmm. And that's the same with every administrator. We try to keep it balanced by not having that administrator have any knowledge or any affiliation with that child or his or her parents or anything like that. So we try to keep it neutral, keep it unbiased.
You try to keep it diverse.
Yes, yes.
You try to equal it out.
Yes. And
to make sure that it's not biased, you don't have too many of either color. If I'm enough, I don't need all three panels twice.
We just try to keep it as balanced as possible. Sometimes you might have a tribunal where you have to go with what you can get, because sometimes you might want to try to keep it as neutral like that, but that person might say, hey, I already know that family, I don't want any involvement with that. So we try to alleviate those problems and eliminate them by keeping that panel as consistently as we can keep it without that person having any knowledge of that particular student. So that's how we do this.
I was just
going to
say, I also go through hearing training.
Yes, yes. And we, at the end of every year, last couple of years, we had to watch some modules through Mr. Jimmy Stokes with Gail, and he actually has them to go through training. Any updates for the upcoming year, they have to be certified that they've completed that training before they can be on the tribunal for the upcoming year. So probably in May or June, Dr. Jimmy Stokes will send that information out. And all administrators that we want to be a part of that, every administrator in the system has to go through that training.
We'll say like 10 of them that's been through the training. So now, since we have 10 now running to a child that just know all 10 of them, so what do you do on those particular?
We have so many administrators that rarely happens that way.
Really?
Yes, okay. It rarely happens that way. And sometimes, like Dr. Cummins, because he's at the 10th grade, 11th and 12th, if it's a middle school student, we might not have him come up there because that child in the future is going to be under his leadership at Coffey High School. So we try to think of all those parameters to balance things out so that we keep it consistent. That way we keep everybody trying to be as fair as we possibly can be. But at the same time, when they come in here at that tribunal, they hear the information presented by the school side and the student side, those tribunal members, those three administrators, it's in their hands at that point. Whatever recommendation comes from that school, like that, if that school official recommends expulsion for the remainder of the 2021 school year,
and also expulsion into the first semester of the 2021-2022 school year. Once they make that recommendation on information that'll bear on appropriate punishment, they make that recommendation, they give a closing statement for the school side and the parent side. Well, at the same time, once both sides say what they got to say, the parent might ask, I only want virtual for my child. They deliberate on that. I'm out of the meeting at that time. They talk about what they want to do. We come back in from recess, and then they tell us what the outcome is for this particular student for remaining of this school term. And if they want, they, a tribunal can add a full year next year if they wanted to, or any year. They have the liberty to do that based upon the law when there's a governance school tribunal. So at that point, I've seen tribunals add more, and I've seen tribunals take away and put less. But they have the discretion to do that. And when I was doing, I was on that side of being a chair of tribunals. Well, what we tried to do during those times with Dr. Mumford in, I think it was April, they only called us during the morning of, or the day of the tribunal. We had no other exposure about the case 2 or 3 days before. We didn't know. They called me that morning. I got to my office at 9 o'clock. Dr. Banks, I need you to come over here to do a tribunal. And if I had no attachment to the child, they cleared, April would clear it with me that I had no affiliation with that child or parent, and I would come out here and do the tribunal. But we try to keep it as balanced and unbiased as possible. Nope. We try to keep it impartial if we can. Because it's a violation if you know the child, you know the situation, and then what we expect, well, you're going to try to change something. You're not being fair to the case if you do that. So we try to keep it as balanced as possible.
I want to tell them that the letter the school system sends out informs them that they've got the right to get an attorney, which they often do, and they've got a right to subpoena witnesses and documents,
right,
which sometimes they do.
Right. And going through that process, when a child has an infraction at any school in our system, no matter what it is, if they violate anything we put in level 4, they have to put a charge letter to it. Anything on level 4 you see up there that goes to my officer from that school standpoint, that administrator has to write a charge letter. And they also sent a charge letter to Dr. Leach, myself, April Thomason, and they also sent a charge letter, a part of that letter for tribunal, to the parent, making them aware of what happened. In our charge letter, they will tell us who the witnesses they may have that's going to come and testify if it goes to tribunal. And the reason I say if it goes to tribunal is because the parent and that family, they have an option to sign a waiver. If they sign a waiver, what that waiver indicates to us is the parent says, my child is guilty, I'm not going to fight it through tribunal, I will sign the waiver, you guys are giving us an option to go to the alternative school, I want to take that option to go to the alternative school in lieu of going to the tribunal. So when they say, I believe my child is guilty, April Thompson devises a waiver. She gives the waiver to that parent. They sign it, and hopefully the next day, they get a chance to call Ms. Amanda Murphy at the alternative school or Ms. Tanya LaShore, and they get an opportunity to go for orientation at the alternative school. The alternative school is not mandatory when we give you that option, but to have a continuation of learning, it's better to go to the alternative school than to shut it off. Okay?
Great. Great job, Dr. Banks.
Well, I'm telling y'all what we go for. So I'm clearing you up. So my time limit is coming. Go ahead, number 26.
I want to say one thing before I get too far away from that vapor. Okay, you the level fence dropped. So what was this same thing like the holes in the pants? Because it was a level 3, right? Then you said it has dropped to a level 2.
I think what's been happening with the level, the reason that dropped that way is because there's been a multitude of kids vaping. And they were getting too far behind in studies, being suspended away from school. So they felt that to modify that and give them more education by completing the module first, it would give them more education about why they should not do that type of activity at all. So that was the reason why they wanted to do it that way. And it gave them more layers, more consequences, and gave them more to have a progressive discipline plan
to help those students stay in school. Because that's one thing in our culture right now, is really getting really, really widespread. Instead of an epidemic, that part is becoming a pandemic for some kids. So we're doing all we can to alleviate and mitigate to help kids get better.
Yeah. Well, thank you, though.
I know you're talking about time. Go to 26, Reverend Chan. I'll get out your way. All right, right quickly, they talked about bus violations. Kids fighting on a bus, doing volatile things on a bus. The middle school felt that 30 days bus suspension is enough. They felt that they were giving kids a double whammy when they had to be suspended off the bus 30 days and suspended from school 5 days. So that's the route they wanted to take going into next year. That's a proposal to the board tonight. And let's scroll up to page 30, Shane. I'm going to get out of the way. I'll take up too much of y'all's time. All right. That's a change to tardy. That's simplistic right there for next year. About the same as it was this year. They just giving Swiss forms in there, give kids more opportunities to stay in the classroom in lieu of being suspended at home and in school suspension. Go to the next page, 31, and I'll be out your way. All right, there. One thing about the offense and the double whammy is that they talked about with the middle school and the freshman campus felt the same way. They wanted 30 days bus suspension without giving kids 5 days home suspension from school, keeping kids in school. Coffee High School wanted to keep, well, you see that it's not highlighted, but they wanted to keep the first offense as 5 days home, 5 days from school, and 30 days bus suspension. And the reason for that being is sometimes when kids get into a fight on the bus, they carry it into the school building. So sometimes you have to give kids a time away from school to cool off. They need a cooling off period. So if you keep them in school, they're going to probably sometimes fight more. So to keep from having further problems, the high school wanted to still continue the way they were doing this year. They're pretty much on a rollout and status quo for next year, as we already have this year. And that's all I have.
Mm-hmm. Let me hold you up just 1 minute.
Go ahead.
I didn't want to hijack stuff here, but I do want to talk about what we were talking about a minute ago, because we have had a lot of that come up over the last week or so with some issues. And this is probably the only time we get to it as a board or school system to clarify some things in public. So I want to make sure that we put it out there like it is. When a child commits I've run past the page, let's say a level 4 offense.
Yes, sir.
All right, and we say that child is suspended. It doesn't mean that's the only thing that's going to happen to that child, but the process we go through is that child is immediately suspended pending tribunal, which means they're off the campus, out of school until we can get our stuff together to have a trial for that child or whoever, to see what punishment they actually do get. So by saying they're suspended does not mean that we have suspended them for that offense. It just means that's the process we go through until we can have a tribunal and see the facts of that case and see what punishment that child actually does need.
Exactly.
And then at that point, it goes to a tribunal who you just went through, I think pretty well how that's chosen, how that's set up. And then the school will recommend a punishment. And that tribunal can hear that case for whatever witnesses or what have you that family calls or does. And then they can decide to keep that punishment, make it less severe, more severe, depending on what they heard in that trial, which is private. And then that is pretty much, that's the punishment that child gets at that point. Unless, I guess, the parent does not approve of it, doesn't like it, then they can appeal it, and then it would work its way on up.
And then it would come to the board.
If that child said, I think they gave me too much, I'm going to appeal it. Then at that point, then they could bring it to us to basically view the tribunal and see what we thought about it. And that's pretty much the process from start to finish with a level 4 offense. That's how.
And I will say, in 20 years, I will tell you, we have a strong process in place. But the thing is, these are different times we're living in right now.
Absolutely.
And when you have a situation, you can even say with level 4 or level 3, you can even say 5 days pending further investigation.
Yeah.
Same thing as 10 days pending. That key word is pending.
Yeah.
That means it's not over yet.
But I think the interpretation of some people that don't know sometimes thinks, oh, well, they just suspended them for a few days, and maybe that they let them off lighter, like, you know, and that's not necessarily the case. They're still, the other thing I wanted to clarify is that some of these level four offenses, I know we've got a big section on weapons and things like that. Some of these level four offenses, we have our part of that situation, and then law enforcement has their part of that situation. So when we have a level four offense that does have some kind of law enforcement, you know, basically our responsibility is to notify them, and then they take it from there. They're part of that, and then we handle our part of the school system. How exactly does that work?
Well, the part of that is what happened about 3 years ago, we added another layer to our investigative practices in Coffee County. When you add the chief of police for our safety department, okay, you add another layer, because now, instead of going to me right offhand, they have a chance to go to Mr. Chris Elrod. Okay, when you bring somebody into your system with over 26 years of law enforcement experience, and you couple that with what we already have in place as far as our policies and our procedures for how we operate, you are going to get stronger, and that's what we've done. So I think that the investigative part of what we do, we are stronger right now. We have room for improvement, but I do know that we're getting better, because I'm gonna tell you, when that law enforcement guy Chris Arrow came on the scene, it helped out a lot with some of the social media stuff. It helped out right off the bat. So that gives me a layer to work with him. And also, let me tell you an important piece of social media, because things go viral very, very quickly. All right, so when he operates, he also has Dr. Chan Newell with technology. We can put some things out there to let the stakeholders know what is going on, that we are working on this, and the conclusion hasn't been brought to our attention yet, because there's more evidence and more work that we have to do. So sometimes situations can take 2-3 weeks, but we still get the information, because there's more strands that we have to go through. But I would say, in conjunction with law enforcement, district attorney's office, we try to work together to bring the best for all of our students in this particular area. Now, do we please everybody with what we do? No, we don't. Jesus had a problem pleasing the Pharisees. So I know that people, in the nature of humankind, we're not going to please everybody with what we do. But at least we give every situation due diligence to bring peace to our community. So that's what I have to say.
Dr. Banks,
Mr.
just real quickly, I want to make a statement first. I appreciate all the time you spent up there tonight talking this through. And my statement is this: we spend an inordinate amount of time and resources and money and staff to deal with 48 pages of how to go to school. That's disappointing to me. As a parent, it's disappointing to me as a board member. I will say this, I appreciate all the efforts that you put into this. I'd like some clarification on bullying. I noticed that it's not in the levels. We've got a separate statement for bullying that says we're a no-tolerance bullying organization. I know you've heard this from me before. When a bullying issue is brought forward to a teacher, a parapro, an administrator, whatever it is, I'm still a proponent of all parties need to sit down at the table, right? I think in some instances, and I think we've seen something recently, where folks could not cope with whatever was going on with their lives, and they acted out in a way that it's going to be real difficult moving forward for them. And you know, I think we saw a lot of things in reaction to that in the community, which is quite frankly. I was disappointed to see the level of vitriol and I'm thinking to myself, you know what, we're dealing with children, and we've got to be compassionate, we've got to be loving, but at the end of the day, you know, where does bullying fit in with the levels, right? And because it's not, and I know people want to parse words, people want to take that document and use it in a way that we're not trying to use that document, right? But if they say, well, bullying's not even any of the levels, how are you going to suspend my child for bullying? Or the other way, this child's been bullying my child, what are you going to do about that? And so my question tonight is that something that we can look at modifying in the handbook? So there is some shared responsibility at the homes, because the issues that we're dealing with, that you, and I know that this is the truth, I've been up here with you for a long time, the issues that we've been dealing with now that we were dealing with 10 years ago are deeper, they're more disruptive, but they're being brought to us. Does that you understand what I'm saying? We're not teaching this. We're teaching ABC, we're teaching math, science, history. You know, we are teaching some behavior modifications that we've had to take on. But there's nowhere in our curriculum about how to bully other children. So, you know, what's ended up on our responsibility is we're having to take it on. You know, we need help. We need help with that. We need help with that from our community. We need help with that from our parents and our families. And then we'll do everything in our effort. And I know you do this. I know you shared with me things when you were principal at the freshman campus, the things that you did for young people. And I know the majority of our folks in our school system do feel the same way about the children in their classroom. So to say I appreciate all that, I do. And I know it's frustrating for you to have to be up here and talking through this. We do this every year with the handbook. I know we do. We try to get it right. But we need help. We need help. Because we're here to teach school. We're here to have school. And these issues that we're having to deal with tonight have taken up an awful lot of time, awful lot of money, taxpayers' money, have nothing to do with reading, writing, and arithmetic.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
I totally agree. I just want to emphasize on bullying as well. Some mama girl is being bullied at Capella.
Quick thing.
Yeah, okay.
With bullying, it's up to that administrator to put it into the bullying category. He or she has to look at the situation, evaluate the situation. Okay, one incident, let's document what's going on. Do we see anything visibly? Do we have anything from Gaggle that's written? Do we have any verbal? Do we have any verbal comments that we know that the person made? All right, with bullying, what we try to do, we try to establish a pattern. If you got three incidents of bullying, it's supposed to get to a point of level 4. All right, but the problem happens sometimes with most situations, we go so fast. Can you show me something that I can see that is happening?
Let me tell you.
Go ahead.
Especially for young ladies. I've got a daughter. I've been through middle school. I've been through high school. I've been through it. This is the meanest thing in the world right here. Reaching out to one another outside of school, inside of school, all those things. What I'm saying is the issues that this causes, right? You can't just pick up the phone on the party line anymore, right? And you can't just leave a note for somebody. It gets done this way. It gets done secretively. And it's causing a lot of damage. Unfortunately, that damage is showing up on our campuses. And the coping skills aren't there to mesh with this technology. And, you know, it's difficult. I know you're in a difficult position. But to me, that bullying piece is that there's a lot going on with this that I think is damaging to our children.
Because I'm in a difficult position as a board member. I've talked to them about my little girl, about her being bullied. And you know, children don't bully in public. They don't bully in front of the teacher. As soon as the teacher turn ahead, you know, they're gonna be the tail. So, and I've talked, so it's to the point of where I'm trying to teach my little girl, you better go and bust in my face. And it's wrong that I'm telling her that, but I'm tired of my little girl being bullied. You know, so it's just a lose-lose situation in this. Because now she going bust in the face, now she got to get kicked out of school because that's what I told her to do. But I don't want my little girl taking her life because she's scared of this little girl. You know, but when you report it over and over again and don't nobody see that it's bullying to them, because they hadn't actually heard nothing or seen nothing. But if a child keep coming back to you over and over and over again about a person, something is to it. Because she's been coming back to me over and she's crying, "Mama, I'm scared of that little girl," you know? But what can I do besides, you know, try to teach her some moves?
All right. And we'll look into these issues that we talked about in the handbook and get back with the board at that May 6th meeting and try to have some answers. Audience participation. I have a Miss Amanda Bill. All right. And as far as audience participation goes, we have some standards that we follow in dealing with public participation. While board meetings are public meetings and not meetings of the public, it has long been the policy and practice of this Board of Education to encourage citizens in our county to attend meetings of the board and allow citizens to offer their suggestions, comments, and concerns about our schools toward the end of regularly scheduled work sessions that are held prior to each monthly meeting. Of course, our citizens are invited to discuss their concerns with our board members at times other than just when the board is meeting. This is also true of the superintendent, who welcomes your comments, input, and suggestions and ways to improve our schools. Persons desire to address the board should sign up and not name any particular staff members or students or anything of that nature. The individual will have 5 minutes, and if there is a group present, they could have 10 minutes if they want to designate one person to speak. But we would ask that don't bring up any issues that involve individual students' names or parents' names or staff members' names, and the board will not hear oral complaints or criticism regarding school personnel during public meetings. And before we get started, I'm sorry, but I did have a statement that I wanted to read in relation to an incident we had that occurred at Coffey Middle School recently. And I wanted to go ahead and read this statement because I see from the topic that wants to be discussed, it relates to the statement that I had prepared. So I wanted to go ahead and read this statement. On March 30th, the Coffey Middle School administration heard about a so-called kill list, and after investigating the matter, the student who wrote the list was suspended. The student who had shared the list on social media was absent that day but was suspended the following day. Both students received 5 days pending further investigation. School resource officers became involved with the case, and the matter was reported to the district attorney's office, and charges against the two students are now pending. On April 12th, school administration called both parents to inform them the investigation was over and that their child would be suspended 10 days pending a tribunal where expulsion was being recommended. Neither student has been back on the campus of Coffey Middle School since before spring break, with the exception of one student who came with her mother to a required meeting in the front office on April 15th. Two administrators attended the meeting and an SRO was stationed outside the door. The principal reported to the superintendent that the assistant principals on 7th grade hall, along with the counselor and secretary, contacted all parents of the students identified on the list to make them aware of the situation as well as assure them that their child was safe. According to the principal, an option of the students meeting with the counselor was also provided or offered. Since there has been reported to the superintendent that some parents have stated that they were not contacted, the principal was directed to make sure this was done as of this morning. So I just wanted to read this statement to everybody to before we move forward with public participation. All right? Yes, ma'am.
First of all, thank you for letting me speak. My child was on that list. I, as a parent, was not contacted.
Yes, ma'am.
When I called the 7th grade administration, they told me no parents were contacted. So I don't know, from social media, parents are saying I was contacted, but then When I call the school, they say no one was contacted. I was never contacted. Email, text, nothing. We get all these text messages and alerts from schools about fundraisers, academic stuff, sports stuff, but yet we don't get informed about this. And I have a few questions as far as, one, why is law enforcement, why were they not put in this the first day that it happened? When you have a kill list or a hit list, it's no longer an educational thing. It is a criminal thing, in my opinion. I'm not willing to sacrifice number 49 on that list. And there have been too many school shootings not to take this serious. People, reporters of Douglas now, are trying to talk this down and compare it to having sex in bathrooms and drugs on school. This is not the same ballgame. We're not talking about activities that are done in school. We're talking about lives that could be lost. And from what I'm told from the chief of police, he was not informed. He was the superintendent, knew. But my thing is, why hold 60 lives at stake? If you had all 60 of those kids or adults or whoever was on that list in this room, could you confront each one of them and look them in the eyes and tell them, you as board members or superintendent or faculty, staff, whatever, have you protected them to your best ability? And right now, I don't think that any of them could say that. Because right now, there's still a child that titled that list at the school. She was walking around in the hallways on Tuesday. My child that is on that list lost her father not even 2.5 years ago. That's why we moved back home, so I could be with family and raise my kids with family. Now her name's been put on a kill list, and this child is still walking the halls that titled this Summer Kill List 2021. And now she has to see this child in school, and she's not been taken out of school. And I contacted the school. I've tried to talk to the principal 3 days in a row, and I finally spoke with him today to inform him of this in case no one knew. But my question is, why was law enforcement not brought into this? Why were all parents not contacted? Because there's not very many kids with my child's name and last initial. And if it's seventh grade, it's not rocket science. You have an enrollment, you know all these kids, you know by what they go by, because we have to fill it out on 5 different pieces of paper, what their name, last name, and what they go by. So that was my one thing. And are we going to be informed? Are the parents going to be updated as far as what happens to these children that did this? And I don't understand, it's been almost 4 weeks. Why now? Why are we just now be informed? Why do we have to wait for WLB to get involved and not hear it? Why was the meeting not called for the seventh grade school or class as a meeting that all parents should attend to let them know, hey, this is what happened. Your child was on this list. These are the steps that we have taken, and this child has been removed, so that we get reassurance. Everybody wants reassurance, and I feel like we haven't gotten any. These kids haven't gotten any. There's counselors all in the school system, and not one child has been seen by a counselor since this has happened. This has been 4 weeks going, almost. So my question is, why was law enforcement not in? Why have counselors not been talking to these children? They need to be talked to. I mean, they were put on a hit list at seventh grade. So that was just my questions and concerns as me, as a parent, that was not contacted. I just need some answers. I need some reassurance that my child is okay and that she's being protected to the best of her ability and to the best of y'all's ability. Thank you.
Dr. Lee, you got nothing to comfort her with that's safe? You know, because I thought the children was out of school. I didn't know they were still in school. I thought one of the children was out.
I read this statement. I'll look into what was stated there, but I read the statement as it's been presented to me and all the evidence. So.
We don't have counselors. Any kind of plan, do you know?
Can I speak again for just a moment on that, Mr. Jowers? When I called the school today, he told me that they had been working on it, but they only had one counselor in that school.
Okay.
but there's more counselors in the school system. When something like this happens, they should be able to pull them to talk to these kids and not wait 4 weeks.
Okay. Thank you. You gonna see about that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Well, and I would say that counseling sessions are confidential, and I respect, you know, the idea that nobody's been talked to, but I will check on what the facts are. I will look into what the facts are, all right, and work off the facts.
Right. I just definitely think she brought some things we need to look into.
Yes, sir.
If something that we're not doing as well as we need to do, we need to find out why we did not. We need to make sure it's correct.
I agree.
But I was told something different. So, you know, and that's what I passed on. When I talked to you, you told me to tell those people, those children that are not in school and won't be back, this is what you said.
Yeah.
So, and for her to say that she talked to her children, saw the girl down the hallway in school. I mean,
that's news to me. I've not heard that before until right now.
She's
so we'll
the title of the list. This child did.
We'll certainly follow up with that. I'll get with you and you can give me the name of the child and we'll get law enforcement and school administration on it tomorrow. Let's see if we can.
So we're not going to
tomorrow.
All
right. All right. Who is up next? Miss Peggy Mazur.
I'm there with her, support her, so she's backing up a little bit.
And Miss Tracy Toombs.
Concerned parent, well, grandparent, well, just like a parent to him. My grandson, he do attend Coffey Middle School, and he was not one of the ones that was on the list, but him going out there, he was very concerned when he found out about it, and he let me know what was going on, and I told him, well, I'm going to look into it and talk to someone about the situation, because he was at the point he did not want to go back to school because of the situation, and then the list floated out on social media. He got a hold to it and he sent it to me. And I looked at it. He seen the list and we talked about the list and a couple of people that's on the list, especially one, but he's a friend of the boy. They have gym together, they play football together at Coffey Middle. And he was like, well, now, if their name is on the list, that don't mean that they gonna do something to the people that's on the list. It could be meaning they gonna do something to the people that's not on the list. And so say if that we all out and about at school, something do happen, then what? And I said, well, I don't really know what to say, but I'll find out about it. And do need something need to be done, because I feel like even though the kid that was on the list, if they parents didn't get in contact, everybody should have really got in contact. Every parent that got a child at Coffey Middle School should have been notified about this situation. Because of that, we have a lot of killings in school system today. And don't no parent want to do nothing. The school system don't want to do nothing about the situation until something really do happen. And I listened to them on Douglas Now, how they were talking about on Douglas Now. Okay, suppose something do happen, then you do something. That's too late. I mean, this is a smart boy that never want to miss school at all. And for something like this to go on, he don't want to go to school. Not just go to school, he ain't even want to play football because of the situation. And that's on the outside. He outside. He didn't even want to go play football. But I talked to him about going back to school yesterday. And when he went back to school yesterday, he came home yesterday talking to me about it because some kids were talking about it. He came home today talking to me about it, saying they sort of do a lockdown at the schoolhouse, because some of the kids got threatened today. I don't know if this was going, what was going on with the kill list or with something else, but this is what was told to me today about a lockdown at Coffey Middle School. Now, I don't know what's going on, but I need, and me as a parent, need to know what's going on. Me sending my child to school, and especially when the law enforcement is not being involved, somebody need to tell me something. I don't want to get that phone call and say, or get that text message, or have to look on social media. It's a shooting or something out there at Coffin Middle School, and my baby out there, and I just on the mind. Some of our babies are out there in mess, all because we did not do nothing about the situation at hand. So I feel like something needs to be done. The law enforcement needs to be brought in. Need to be brought in and square the situation. Because our kids are really literally scared. And it should have been more parents than talking about it. Our kids are literally scared. Really don't know what to do. Whether they name on the list or not on the list. They are really, they are talking about this amongst themselves. They're not saying nothing to the teachers or the council or the principal, but they're talking about this amongst themselves. So something needs to be done. Something needs to be handled, and it needs to be done soon.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Carter.
Yes, sir. I'll definitely check on it. I do want to point out that I did say this earlier, that school resource officers became involved with the case and the matter was reported to the district attorney. The district attorney is law, that's law enforcement. So the matter was reported to the district attorney's office and charges against the two students are pending. So law enforcement was involved and charges are pending through the district attorney's office. So I just want to make sure that's clear. And I said it earlier, but I'll say it again.
But the thing is, Dr. Lee, you did wait until you saw somebody on the list to talk about this. It should have been, like, this happened 3-4 weeks ago. Right. These folks should have been knowing something. This is scary to me.
Oh, I agree.
It's something that shouldn't have been waiting on. I mean, when you saw the list tonight, then you decided to read this, we wouldn't have never known what was on your list until you seen them on the list. I mean, this is scary.
I agree.
It's scary.
It is. Yes, ma'am. I agree with you.
Okay. Next. Anybody else on?
We've got Dominic Laricchio.
Thank you, Dr. Lease, and Chairman Jowers, and board members. I appreciate you letting me speak to you a few minutes, and I'm going to try to bring a different feel to this conversation, or a little bit of a different perspective, certainly a unique perspective. Like many of you, I wear several hats. I don't think I have to tell y'all that one of the hats that I wear is the state representative for this district. We have the same responsibility that you have times, I think it's 180 or so school systems, 159 counties, but I'm also a parent of Olivia Laricchia, a 7th grade 13-year-old at the middle school whose name was on the list. And as I heard about it, and I began to try to think about how to absorb everything, I've learned some valuable lessons as a state representative, and I think one of the most valuable lessons I've learned is to be patient and let the process work. And patience is something I don't have much of, but I think particularly in government, that is the way things work, that there is a process. There is no perfect blueprint to how you resolve problems or issues like this, because they're all so different. And the totality of the circumstances are always different. And so I took a deep breath, and I actually waited a couple of days, and I was contacted by Ms. Berry about the list, and she was, I think, as helpful as she could have possibly been with those few days of what was happening. I think spring break was right there. And she was very helpful in trying to tell me what was going to happen next in the process. And so that helped me to be patient. But I also have a unique perspective on the Department of Education and how our local school systems handle these. And I think that Mr. Banks did a great job of trying to explain to us how these are handled according to the student handbook. And I was being contacted by multiple parents via Facebook messages, text messages, phone calls, and my response was almost always the same. I understand your frustration and your concern. I'm a parent, I'm concerned too. But these students have rights, they have protections, there's confidentiality, there's a process that they have to go through. I'm not going to eat up a lot of your time, you know, dwelling on that, because I wanted to also, it's been over a year now that this pandemic has hit. There was no blueprint as to how the governor would handle that. There was no blueprint as to how these local school systems would handle a pandemic. And as my wife and I began to talk about this, and I would think about it from a parent's perspective, and I would think about it from a state representative's perspective, and I would ask, you know, I would always try to listen for God to give me some wisdom or some guidance. Here's what I've come up with. Is that I owe you and this school system an apology as a parent. Because when my daughter's name was on that list, I immediately started kind of thinking about, well, whose fault is it? Let me tell you whose fault it is not. It is not this school system's fault. It's not Ms. Berry's fault. It's not the teacher's fault. It's not the board member's fault. It's not the state of Georgia's fault. I've never reached out to Ms. Berry and said, how can I help you in your school system? How can I participate and get engaged and be a part of solutions and be a part of helping address the concerns? I've never done that. And I'm a state representative. I probably need to apologize that maybe my daughter's not real familiar with how to address some of these problems when she came to me as a dad. I get to see what you do every day from a perspective that a lot of people don't get to see. I know exactly how she feels about her child's name being on that list. I know exactly. But now from a state representative's perspective, you very seldom have people come to this podium and say, thank you for what you do. I pray for my daughter every morning before I drop her out of middle school. She holds my hand till the time we pull in there to the drop-off line, and we pray for safety for the other kids, the teachers. We thank God for a beautiful day, and we always close with, help us love you more and love others. That's the way we close every prayer. I've never dropped my child off that I was really worried about her again until I picked her up. Because I get to see how much time and resources is spent on school security and cameras and resource officers and hall monitors and people making sure that our children are protected the same way you tried to protect them during the pandemic last year. So I'll close with a thank you. Is that I can't name all of the different people that it takes to run this system, from the nutrition staff to the bus drivers to the administrators, school teachers, parapros, and everybody. But when I was prepared to get ready to try to call somebody and tell them what I thought they should have done, God said, no. There is no perfect solution to problems like this. I had to be patient and trust the process and let it work. And as best I can tell, you are very deep into that process. With the district attorney's office, going to be taking some action, I'm sure, with expelling, handling these children. So I apologize as a parent for taking for granted the tremendous responsibility that you have for how many, 11, 12,000, how many children in this school system?
7,700
children that we have given you the tremendous responsibility of keeping safe every day. And I am admitting that I have not one time called the principal and said, how can I help you? You call me if I can ever help you. And I don't think I've ever been to this boardroom or to a school system and said thank you. But when I saw that list, the first thoughts that came through my mind was, who can I blame? So I'm here to tell you, I want to help you. I'm here to tell you, thank you for what you do. And I want these parents to know that I'm in 100% support of any ideas that they have to make sure this doesn't happen again. I'm 49 years old. I came through the Coffee County system. This is the first I've ever heard of a situation like this, particularly compounded by social media. I'd be glad to answer a question if you had any, but those are my comments. Mr. Chairman, thank y'all so much.
Thank you.
I want to say this, Mr. Loretti. I want to say this, you know, on behalf of some of the parents that have went through this, that specifically the one that came in and talked or whatever, I know she wished her daughter was named Loretti, because you was, you know, privileged enough to get a phone call. They weren't. They wasn't privileged to get that phone call. So now you can feel their pain of, you know, they can't say that it's on them. They can only fault somebody else's. And I'm one of the board members. And if they fault me, I just got to take it, because I didn't know. And I wish I could have been more of help to these people. Because, see, it frightens me, because I got grandchildren in the school system. And it frightened me when I find out about it. And I didn't hear about it until two, 3 weeks later, and I'm on the school board. So, and I wish I had a little Ricky on the list of where they could have called me immediately. Sometimes we're privileged enough to get those phone calls early.
Can I respond?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I think it's dishonest and disingenuous of you to allege that they care more about Olivia Loretta than they do any other child in that school.
No, I didn't.
Now, it's a neat soundbite for you to be able to say that, but I'm telling you right now that I have talked to numerous parents that were contacted. If some were not, Dr. Leese, less than just a few minutes ago, said, I will follow up on that and get to the bottom of it. But I can promise you that if my name had been Smith or Vickers, or if it had been Tanner, whatever, there's those 60 children on those lists, or however many. I was told that they were trying to contact the parents of all those children. And for you to say that because I'm a state representative and because my daughter's last name is Loretta, that's why I was contacted, I think it's flat out dishonest and disingenuous, and that's not the way you lead this school system.
Well, you can walk off how you want to and think that that's what it is, but hey, it is what it is. You was called, and this lady said she wasn't called.
Okay. So, we're going to adjourn the work session of the Coffee County Board of Education. This time, we'll be back in a few minutes. We'll make it.